church. Amen. Good morning, everyone. Welcome to the branch. It's good to see everyone here. The Bible says how good and pleasant it is. We all come together and worship God. Amen, church?
Amen.
It is a good thing that we're all here and that we're praising God in one voice, in unity. In spite of what's going on in our hearts and our minds, this is the time to lift it up to God. Amen? If you guys are able, would you stand with us? And we're going to sing a couple more songs. Today is communion. We're going to break the bread and share the cup. So on Communion Sunday, we usually do creed. And you guys pretty much know it, so help us out singing it and just having a good time worshiping God.
Yeah.
Before we sit down, go ahead and just find somebody you don't know, you're not too familiar with, and tell them hello.
Some tough days. Maybe said some things we shouldn't have said. Maybe we did some things we shouldn't have done. But here we are today, gathered together, the house of God, praising God, thanking Jesus. And it's going to be a good, good morning. We're going to be having a service of Holy Communion today.
Bring it up.
Excuse me.
Mike.
Your
mic.
Your mic.
Mike can't hear.
It's going in and out.
Well, I'm all right on this end. The reason I said that was because this morning I forgot to turn it on.
Use lens mic.
Okay. Alright. Good morning, everyone. Aren't you glad you're here today? I'm glad you're here. But just a few announcements. My friend John over here, he's got it. He's got the idea. I was teaching a class yesterday on worship down in Elk at the Elkton United Methodist Church. And I told them, if you would like to have twice as many people coming out on a Sunday morning to worship, I can tell you in 30 seconds how to do it. They said, oh, yeah, I got their attention. I got their attention. And this is what John does. He invites people. If everybody here brought somebody next week, what would that mean? Yeah, it means that the fire marshal would be here. Yeah, invite people. Listen, this is what I say. If you like what's going on here, if you like the message, if you like what's happening here, you invite people. I hear people all the time, like on Facebook, here, social media, all the time, saying, what a great restaurant that is over there. What a great whatever is there. A clothing store, whatever. They tell people about it all the time. And they'll also tell if they don't like it. They'll say, I'm done there. So downstairs, on the high tables, or different tables, we have these invite cards for Easter. And we're sending out a couple thousand of them into the neighborhood. They have the hours here. Everything's right here. Invite people out. Why wouldn't we? Why? Why wouldn't we? We also have these cards. Get connected. We have hundreds of these, don't we, Lynn? Hundreds of these cards. Get connected. You don't even have to say anything to anybody. Just walk up to them and hand them a card. That's all you got to do. You don't have to say anything. If you really want to get their attention, here's how you really want to get somebody's attention, okay? You take one of these cards, and you clip a dollar bill to it and hand somebody and walk away. You're going to get their attention real fast. What is going on with that preacher? That's how you do it, though. A few announcements. Hope Church, April 9th, Palm Sunday, is having a luncheon. So you'd have to be here this service, or go to Hope Church that day on Palm Sunday, and then stay for lunch, and then they're going to have a Easter egg hunt for the children. So you want to do that? Go up and do that, and that would be great. There's a group here in the church called the Rebecca Circle, and they're having a bake sale on April 23rd. And that's really cool. But here's what the cooler thing is. They're raising the money so that when you register a child, grandchild, or a child of yours, whatever, for camp, we pay for the whole camp. If you want to go to camp, we'll pay the whole thing. It's a base camp. We'll pay everything. It's worth $500. But there's a registration fee, $50. Well, not everybody has $50 in their budget for that. So what do? We'll pay it. So not only are we going to pay the $50, we're paying the whole camp. So all you got to do is show up. That's all you got to do is show up. When I was a kid, Bobby Himmelberger and I, Bobby and I grew up together. He died a couple weeks ago. I sort of lost track of him. You know how you do that. So Bobby and I were on my dad's property under the apple tree. This sounds poetic. Under the apple tree, you know, talking about stuff. I might have been 8 or 10 years old. I don't know how old I was. And these two guys came walking down the alley and they said, would you guys like to go to camp? We'd say, sure, but we don't have the money to go. Oh, they said, you don't need money. So I got approval from my parents. It was with the Church of the Nazarene in Ephrata. So we went to camp, and Bobby and I went to camp. We had a great time. At the end of the camp, they had prizes for people in the camp. And the one prize was for the best behaved boy there. Now, do you want to guess who won that?
Bobby.
I won it. What are you doing? What's wrong with you? Ken! What's wrong with you? Well, Bobby did have something to say about it. He said, you don't deserve that. Look who died first. Yeah, Bobby. So anyhow, going on. Oh, Bob and I, Clark, we thought that was funny. But anyhow, think about that. Think about sending somebody to camp. We pay the whole thing. So I'm really happy about that. April 9th, there's going to be a take-home dinner for lasagna rolls and salad that they're going to be selling between services. And that, now listen to this. This is something new. That money goes to buy pillowcases that have Bible verses embroidered on it for new members when people join the church. So if you want to join the church, yeah, isn't that nice, Jackie? Yeah. So April 30th, there's a fifth Sunday, we'll be having new members join. There are some people here that are joining, going to be joining. So if you're interested in joining the church, April 30th, fifth Sunday, we have one service at what time? 10 o'clock. And we're going to be giving them a pillowcase. Also, on Tuesday night, we have a Lenten Bible study at Arnie and Scott Nicky's home. If you need to know where that is, you can look in the directory or call in tomorrow. Or on Wednesday, we also have Lenten Bible studies at downstairs that I lead at 12:15 and 7:15. And they're really, aren't they good? Mr. Timms? Aren't they good? Follow this lead.
Wonderful.
Thank you. See that? Wonderful. He comes out. And another thing, if you'd ever want to, you hear us talking about different ministries here, but on Wednesday afternoons at 2 o'clock, we go up to Ivy Gables. There are some other places that Pastor Amy goes to. But if you'd ever like to go along and just for a half an hour, Lynn goes, Anthony goes, Sandy goes, Jackie goes. Different people come up there, and I'll take you up, or you can meet us up there. It's just for half an hour, and we sing songs. Ellie Quick plays the piano. I preach a short message. It's just a good time. And the people there, they love it. They love when we come up there and do that. So some Wednesday afternoon, if you're not doing anything, say, hey, you know what? I wouldn't mind doing that. So think about that as well. Also, on Sunday mornings, now if you do this, you got to come an hour early. But at 10:15... on Sunday mornings, Ellie Quick has a class downstairs, and she might have from 15 to 18 people there, and she discusses the messages that we have here on a Sunday morning. And I know I walked by the door today, and I saw different people in there, and I understand that they have very good classes in there. So think about that, come out and join in, and all the excitement and all the fun that's going on here at the United Methodist Church of the Atonement. We're going to pray for the offering at this time. Father God, you are very, very good to us. Very good to us. And we think, Lord, this season of Lent, how we are to have our lives so arranged that we would just be worshiping you and sacrificing unto you and loving you. But we think of that great sacrifice that Jesus did when he died for our sins. And Father God, I pray that we would give back to you today just some of what you have given us. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Amen.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Today's reading is from the book of Romans. But now apart from the law of the righteousness of God has been made known, to which the law of the prophets testify, this righteousness is given through faith in Jesus Christ to all who believe. There is no difference between Jew and Gentile, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. And all are justified freely by his grace through the redemption that came by Christ Jesus. God presented Christ as a sacrifice of atonement through the shedding of his blood to be received by faith. He did this to demonstrate his righteousness, because in his forbearance he had left the sins committed beforehand unpunished. He did it to demonstrate his righteousness at the present time, so as to be just and the one who justifies those who have faith in Jesus. Where then is boasting? Is it excluded? Because of what law? The law that requires works? No, because of the law that requires faith. For we maintain that a person is justified by faith apart from the works of the law. Or is God the God of Jews only? Is he not the God of Gentiles too? Yes, of Gentiles too. Since there is only one God, who will justify the circumcised by faith and the uncircumcised through that same faith? Do we then nullify the law by this faith? Not at all. Rather, we uphold the law. This is God's word for God's people.
Thanks be to God.
We are going to be entering into a service of Holy Communion at this time. In the United Methodist Church, we have what's called an open communion, which means that you do not have to be a member of this congregation in order to receive Holy Communion. If there's children here that would want to receive Holy Communion, or babies, or whatever, they are welcome at the table. We use juice. We do not use adult beverages. The Bible tells us that we are to use the juice of the vine, and that's what grape juice is. We do that for the two reasons. One is of children, and because we have alcoholics among us here, and we don't want that to be take away from what we're going to be doing here today. So I'm going to be consecrating the elements at this time. And what that means is this. We're setting these elements apart for the service of God. That's what we're doing when we do this. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. All right, to give our thanks and praise. It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. In love you made us for yourself. And when we had failed in assault, fallen into sin, and become subject to evil and death, your love remained steadfast. You bid your faithful people cleanse their hearts and prepare with joy for the Easter feast, that renewed by your word and sacraments, and fervent in prayer and works of justice and mercy, we come to the fullness of grace that you have prepared for those who love you. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ, whom you sent in the fullness of time to redeem the world. He emptied himself, taking the form of a servant, being born in our likeness. He humbled himself and became obedient unto death, even death on a cross. He took upon himself our death and sin, and offered himself a perfect sacrifice for the sin of the whole world. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church and delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. on the night in which he gave himself up for us. He took the bread. He gave thanks to you. He broke the bread, and he gave it to the disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is the body given for you and broken for you. Do this in remembrance of you." When the supper was over, he took the cup. He gave thanks to you. He gave it to the disciples, and he said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for the many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen.
Christ will come again.
Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here, of all of us gathered here. Pour out your Spirit upon all of us that are gathered here today in this place. And on these gifts of bread and wine, make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty God, now and forever. Amen. I'm going to ask those that are going to be helping, they would come forward at this time. We also have gluten-free crackers that will be here if you need to have that. This is the body of Christ given for you. Take, eat, the body of Christ. Body of Christ given for you, and the body of Christ given for you. This is the blood of Christ that was shed for you, Diane. The blood of Christ shed for you, Jeremy. And Erica, the blood of Christ that was shed for you. We're going to have the band come forward. You and I will come over here. And you'll be with Jeremy. And the band will come forward and receive.
We will remember the works of your hand. We will stop and give you praise, for great is thy grace. Great.
I still remember the day you saved me, the day I heard you call out my name. You said you loved me, would never leave me, and I'd never be the same.
Seminary, and there was a group of us sitting around talking, and as we were talking, somebody said, what are you going to be preaching about coming up on Sunday morning? And I said, I'm going to be preaching about the blood of Jesus. And they said, really? All of them. They said, really? And I said, yeah. And they said, we're not allowed to preach on the blood of Jesus at our church. And these are United Methodist churches. I said, really? And they said, no, we're not. And I said, well, why wouldn't you talk about the blood of Jesus? And they said, the reason that we don't is the people in the church, the leaders in the church, said, you know, blood is gory. Blood is messy. We don't want to even think about it. We don't want to talk about it. I'm wondering how you talk about atonement. So we're talking about. I wonder how you talk about Easter or Good Friday without talking about the blood of Jesus.
Amen.
So you see, because of that, there's congregations that don't hear about the blood of Jesus. Yesterday, I was in the living room. I live right back here in the apartment. I have an apartment back here, and Denise and I, we take care of the grandkids over the weekend. You know that. If you're here 2 weeks in a row, you know that. And I was sitting in the living room doing something, and Denise began to yell, Mr. Hornberger, I got blood. Mr. Hornberger, I got blood. So because I'm a trained medic, which I'm not, my mom trained me this. But she came running out of the kid's bedroom, and the little boy was bleeding from the lips. And I went into action. I got a paper towel. I made it wet. And I applied it firmly to his lip. Am I doing the right thing here, guys?
Yeah.
These guys are medics up here. They know what they're talking about. In a little while, the blood stopped. But you see, we had blood. We had blood. In order for us, the Bible tells us the wages of sin is death. But it doesn't stop there. The gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ. How is that debt paid? The debt is paid by the blood of Jesus Christ. When Jesus was on Thursday night, Maundy Thursday, we're talking about now Holy Week, and we're going into Good Friday. And Jesus had had the trial on Thursday nights. The trials were set up. They were, you hear about fake news today? Well, this was fake. This was fake reports, fake trials, fake, everything was fake. And Jesus was sentenced to die. But before he died, they applied to his back 39 times a whip. And the whip was made out of leather. They had leather strands on it. And then at the end of those strands, they had glass put in there. And they had sharp stones put in there, so when they would apply this whipping to his back, and if they would have done it more than 39 times, he would have died on the 40th time. That's why it was just 39 times. And Jesus was not allowed to die any other way but on the cross, because it was prophesied. It was God's plan. It was God's own plan. So they applied this to his back, and when they did, he began to bleed. So the angels in heaven on that day are yelling out, "We got blood! We got blood!" When they took the crown of Jesus and put it on his forehead and pressed down on his head, he began to bleed. The angels in heaven said, "We got blood! We got blood!" When the soldiers saw Jesus dying on the cross, Jesus had to die without a broken bone. That's prophecy. So the other soldiers that were there, the other criminals rather that were there, they broke their bones, they broke their legs so that they would fall down and they couldn't breathe anymore. Not with Jesus. Jesus died a natural death on the cross. And in order to prove that, what the soldiers did was took a spear and they thrust it in the side of Jesus. And he began to bleed. And the angels in heaven began to cry out again, "We got blood, we got blood." Every one of you sitting here today that's hearing my voice, and this is going to be on YouTube here this afternoon, what we're saying is when we came to Christ and we accepted the forgiveness that Jesus gave us, he gave us that forgiveness through the blood of Jesus, or you wouldn't have forgiveness. That's what the atonement was about in the Old Testament. It was the shedding of the blood of goats. It was shedding of the blood of bulls. It was shed of the blood of animals. And the high priest was there. The high priest took care of everything. The high priest took and put his hand in the blood and sprinkled it on the people. He went around like that, put his fingers in the blood and sprinkled everybody, and you wanted to get there. You wanted to go over there. You wanted to have that blood hit you because then you were being atoned for. It was all part of God's plan in order for us to be forgiven. Those people were forgiven. They walked away. But as I said last week, their consciences were not clear. Their consciences were not clear. So what happened? They had to come back next year. What if the priest was having a bad day next year? What if you forgot to say one of the sins that you had broken that year? What if? What if? But when the atonement of Christ took place, and the Holy of Holies, and the curtain tore, and Jesus walked through there, there was no more need for the shedding of blood except for Christ. It was one time, one shot, one done, one deal, and it was all over. So we don't have to go back. We don't have to go back year after year to have our sins forgiven. Does that mean that I don't have to repent of my sins anymore? No, I repent of my sins every day. Every single day. Trust me. If you'd be walking along with me, there's several things you'd hear. You'd hear the prayers. You'd hear the repentance of the sins. And you would hear me praising God. And that's what you'd hear if you'd hang out with me the first hour every morning. But what it means is that Jesus did not have to go to the cross again. It means that Jesus went one time. And he shed that blood. And because of that, we have the atonement. This series of sermons is going to be over today. And next week, I will be up at Hope Church. And then 2 weeks from today will be Palm Sunday, and I'll be here for that. And then the next week will be Easter, and I'll be here, of course, for that. So what we've done in the last month in the series of sermons that we had was why a person asked me one day, why is the name of your church called Atonement? And it's called Atonement because Jesus Christ atoned for us. He took the price of sin, which is death, and he paid that price. So when you're here on a Sunday morning and you're praising God and you're lifting up the name of Jesus, if you want to get excited about that, it's a pretty good reason to get excited. Let me put it to you this way. Let's say that we were on trial for something. Let's say that we were on trial and we were standing before the judge. And you were condemned to die for what you did. That's your sentence. Death. You're scared to death. I would imagine you're scared to death. And the judge sentenced you to death. And then he stands up and he takes off his robe and he comes around and he stands there and he says to himself, I am the judge and I'm setting this person free. Go out into your freedom. Do you think you'd go walking out there? I don't think you are. I think you're tearing out there. I think you're out there praising God.
Amen.
Thank you, Jesus, for what you just did. Let's keep that in mind as we go through the season of Lent. Let's keep that in mind as we go into Good Friday. Let's keep that in mind as we come up to Easter again and realize how serious a crime we did, whatever sin and sins that we have had done, that we did, have been wiped clean. The slate's been wiped clean. And I say this often, it's like a computer putting you X out of something, or you have your computer cleaned up, totally clean, restored all the way back to the beginning. And that's how our lives were when Christ died for us. We went back original to the original way that God wanted it before sin entered the world. The way God wanted it before sin entered the world is how we have been taken care of through the blood shed that Jesus shed for us. So thanks be to God, and we're going to pray and go on. Father, I thank you for this day. I thank you, Father God, for the blood of Jesus. I thank you, Father, that you cared for us, love us so deeply. Love us so deeply that you were willing to stand in our place and die for us. And Father, if I were the only person here on earth, you would have died and shed your blood for me. And for each person that hears my voice, the same thing for them. So, Father, we thank you, we praise you, and we rejoice. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen.
Okay, can we stand one more time? One more time. Sing. I hope we can dance our way out of this place this morning. Amen, church?
I know a place to go. I'm
Hallelujah. You know, I love that song because it talks about stains that make you whiter than snow. Jesus' blood, it takes away those stains and it makes us white as a winter snow. I mean, that's a visual that I just think is awesome. And that's what God promises us, to cover us with his blood and to wash those sins away. If you don't know Jesus as Lord and Savior, please don't leave this room without letting one of us pray for you, whether it's Pastor John, I can pray for you, Jackie, there's many people that would pray with you and over you if you wanted to make that commitment to Jesus this morning. But know that you are loved and wanted or needed in this place. You just go and be the light. Be the light in God's kingdom outside those doors right out there. Amen, church?
Amen.
Go in peace.